فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
ولذلك this مسألة which I mentioned is mentioned extensively and explained highly by Imam Ibn al-Qayyim in his kitab I'lam al-Muwaqqi'in. We're now, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to go into the madahib al-arba'ah, nash'atuha and tatawuruha. We're now going to go into the madahib al-arba'ah. But before we go into, what is it that we agreed on regarding follower madhab? We agreed that attributing to yourself a madhab, there's no harm in that. You can say, I am a Hanafi, I am a Maliki, and I am a Shafi'i, and I am a Hanbali. You can, but it's not wajib, and it is not something to rebuke a person, or it's not something even blameworthy. So it's permissible for you. Good. And the one who chooses not to do it is also permissible for him. But to be fanatic, to reject the evidences when it's brought to you, because of the madhab, is prohibited. And this is not permissible for any individual. When evidence is brought to you forward, and your madhab has gone against it, it's not permissible. Okay? ولذلك, the evidences can be قال الله قال الرسول. And it can also be إجماع. As Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah said in his famous statement, he said, أجمع الناس, the people are unanimously in agreement. على أن من استبانت له سنة عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لم يكن له أن يدعها لقول أحد من الناس كائنا من كان. That it's not permissible for a person after the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has said something for you to oppose it based on a statement of a person. كائنا من كان, whoever that person is. It's an إجماع. That once it's become clear to you that the Imam has said this and the ayah and the Quran have said this, you as an individual now have to follow the dalil. Okay, you have to follow the dalil. Al madahib al arba'a nash'atuha wa tatawuruha. We're now going to start and speak about the four madhabs that there are, how they came about, and how they grew. Let's start with the first of the four. And that is al-madhab al-hanafi, the Hanafi madhab. Who is the person who they attribute themselves to? And who is their imam, the Hanafis? Their imam is Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man ibn Thabit ibn Zawta al-Kufi al-Taymi mawla li-Bani Taym. It said about al-imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he's from the people of Banu Taymullah ibn Tha'laba. And what is also said that he is not even an Arab, he is min abna'i Farisin, he's a Persian. And that's the strongest, inshallah ta'ala. Some scholars, they said that Imam Abu Hanifa himself had gone through slavery. They said that. But what has come from Ismail ibn Hammad ibn Abi Hanifa rahimahumullah, that which negates it, which is the grandchild of Abu Hanifa. He negates that. And he says that his grandfather Abu Hanifa never went through slavery. He was never enslaved. And he rather says that his family were never slaved. And Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, he was born in Kufa when the year was 80 min al-Hijrah, 80 Hijriyah. And Imam Abu Hanifa is an Imam in Fiqh bi ijma' al ulama, by consensus of the scholars. The scholars have agreed in his Imama in Fiqh, that he's an Imam in Fiqh. And they also agree that his khilaf, his differences, and his disagreement with the scholars is also taken into consideration. It's not dismissed. He's a faqihun bila mudafi'. He's a faqih without any dispute and argumentation regarding it. And nobody from the fuqaha and the scholars reject the statement of Abu Hanifa rahimahullah in fiqh. And they praised his fiqh. They praised his knowledge. They even praised his nobility and his integrity, his wara, his fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The people who praised him is Hamad ibn Abu Sulaiman, who died the year 120 Hijriya. Or even maybe a bit before that. فَإِنَّهُ سَأَلَهُ مَرَّةَ عَمْ مَسْأَلَةٍ فِي الطَّلَاقِ. One time, Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he asked his teacher, Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman, a question regarding divorce. And Imam Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman, he gave what he thought was the answer to the question. And then Abu Hanifa started yunazi'u fil mas'ala. He started to argue with him in the particular issue, hatta sakata Hamad. Until Hamad, who's the teacher, went quiet. And so when Abu Hanifa stood up, Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman, he said, هَذَا مَعَ فِقْهِهِ يُحْيِي اللَّيْلَ وَيَقُومُهُ. He says, هَذَا مَعَ فِقْهِهِ. This man with his fiqh, يُحْيِي اللَّيْلَ, he revives the night. وَيَقُومُهُ, and he stands at night. قِيَامُ اللَّيْلَ. This man with the fiqh that you just saw, everyone, and how much knowledge he has, it's also with him, قِيَامُ اللَّيْلَ. Subhanallah. That's the teacher testifying to his own student, his nobility. And this also shows you the nobility of Hamad ibn Abi Sulaiman, which is that he's the teacher. His student is arguing with him, and he doesn't say to him, how dare you respond to me? And how dare you ask me a question two times, three times? Who gave you the rights to speak to me like that? But he really took it on board. And not only that, he praised him for his knowledge, and he praised him for his understanding, and he even praised him for his, he praised him for his prayer and his fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shu'bah ibn Hajjaj, rahimahullah, he said when the Hijriya was, he died, Shu'bah died 160 Hijriya. Shu'bah ibn Hajjaj. Shu'bah, when it reached him, the death of Abu Hanifa. Shu'bah, he heard that Abu Hanifa died. He said, لَقَدْ ذَهَبَ مَعْهُ فِقْهُ أَهْلُ كُوفَةٍ. Abu Hanifa, what went with him is the fiqh of the people of Kufa. He took it with him. The fiqh of Kufa is now buried. Husayn ibn Waqid, we died the year 159 Hijriya. He said, وَقَعَتْ مَسْأَلَةٌ فِي مَرُ. A matter took place in Maru. A issue happened in Maru. Okay? And when it happened, he said, Husayn ibn Waqid said, فَلَمْ أَجِدْ أَحَدًا يَعْرِفُهُ. I didn't find anyone who knew it. فَجِئْتُ إِلَى الْعِرَاقِ. So I came to Iraq. فَسَأَلْتُ عَنْهَا سُفْيَانَ الثَّوْرِي. I asked Al-Imam Sufyan al-Thawri about this issue. فَقَالَنِي, he said to me, يَا حُسَيْن, أو حُسَيْن, لَا أَعْرِفُهَا. I don't know it. This is after بعد أن طرق ساعة. After he put his head down for a while. And he thought, Sufyan al-Thawri said to him, I don't know this. And so then Husayn ibn Waqid said, I said to Sufyan al-Thawri, I said to him, لَا تَعْرِفُهَا وَأَنْتَ إِمَامٌ. You don't know this and you're Imam, Sufyan al-Thawri. And then he said, أَقُولُ كَمَا قَالَ ابْنُ عُمَرٍ. I'm going to say to you what Abdullah ibn Umar said. When he was asked about a matter which he didn't know, what did he say? لَا أَدْرِي, I don't know. Sufyan al-Thawri said, I don't know. And this is what people do to you. They will ask you a question, when you say, I don't know it, they'll say, Akhi, but you've been studying for a while. Is something wrong? You haven't done your homework properly. And this is shayateen now. They're going to make you talk about a mas'ala you have no knowledge of. What do you say? I'll say to you what I said to you before. Ana la adri, I don't know. I don't know. قَالَ فَأَتَيْتُ أَبَا حَنِيفَ. So he said, when that happened, I went to Abu Hanifa. Sufyan al-Thawri didn't know it. So I went to Abu Hanifa. سَأَلْتُهُ, فَسَأَلْتُهُ, I asked him. عَنْهَا, فَأَفْتَانِي فِيهَا. Abu Hanifa responded, gave an answer. فَذَكَرْتُ جَوَابَهُ, I told the response of Abu Hanifa to Al-Imam Sufyan al-Thawri. I went and I told Sufyan al-Thawri. I said, I got the answer, alhamdulillah. And Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, gave me the answer. فَقَالَ بَعْدَ أَن سَكَتَ سَاعَةً. Sufyan al-Thawri went quiet for a little bit. And then he said, يَا حُسَيْن, أو حُسَيْن, هُوَ عَلَى مَا قَالَ لَكَ. It's what Abu Hanifa told you. هُوَ عَلَى مَا قَالَ لَكَ أَبُو حَنِيفَةَ. The answer is exactly as Abu Hanifa told you. This is after we're quiet for a bit. Sufyan al-Thawri said it's as Abu Hanifa told you. So you can see Sufyan al-Thawri, who's an Imam, Mubajjal, honored, respectable Imam, he's doing what? Sawwaba Sufyan qawla Abu Hanifata fi hadhihi al-mas'ala. So he strengthened the opinion of Abu Hanifa in this particular issue. What does that show you? What does that give you an understanding of? Fiqhu. A mas'ala that Sufyan al-Thawri went silent about, couldn't answer, Abu Hanifa was able to answer. Also, Al-Hasan ibn Salih, who died in the year 159 Hijriya, he said, كَانَ النُعْمَانِ بْنُ ثَابِتٍ يَعْنِي الْإِمَامُ أَبُو حَنِيفَةٍ فَهِمًا. He was a faqih. فَهِمًا here means a faqihan. He was a faqih. مُتَثَبِّتًا فِي عِلْمِهِ. And he was a person who was grounded and rooted in his knowledge. إِذَا صَحَ عِنْدَهُ الْخَبَرُ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَمْ يَعُودْهُ إِلَى غَيْرِهِ. And he was also a person who would verify Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. If a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was authentic to him, he wouldn't go to anything other than it. Again, this is an answer to some of the people who say that Abu Hanifa would dismiss a hadith. La, Abu Hanifa rahimahullah wouldn't. The Imam. If a hadith came to him and he saw it, an Imam Abu Hanifa, he would not go to anything other than it. Sa'idun rahimahullah, he said, Kana Abu Hanifa rahimahullah jahuran bima ya'taqidu annahu al-haq. That Abu Hanifa was an individual that whatever he believed to be the truth, he will vocalize it. He would say it out in the open. He wouldn't hide it. He will vocalize it. Also, he said, Sa'id ibn Abi Aruba said, in 156 Hijriya, Qadimtu al-Kufa. Sa'id ibn Abu Aruba, rahimahullah, he said, I came to Kufa, and I sat in the gathering of Abu Hanifa. Fadakara yawman Uthman ibn Affan. And he mentioned Uthman ibn Affan, and he sent rahmah on him, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. That's what he said. Then I said to him, Tarahham ala Uthman, wa huwa fil kufati fi zamanihi wa zamanu fitnatin. And you have to imagine, Abu Hanifa's time, Kufa, is where the Rafid and the Shia are from. So these places, when people are there, these kind of statements that they say are observed of Uthman. What is he going to say? If you go in Iran, and somebody says Uthman, you're listening, what is he going to say after that? Radiallahu ta'ala anhu. That's good. So Abu Hanifa rahimahullah came from Kufa, was land which was known for rafd and tashayyu. So he said, Qultu tarahama ala Uthman wa fil Kufa. Sa'id ibn Abu Aruba said, I said to myself, he has sent mercy and asked Allah's forgiveness for Allah to be pleased. On who? For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be pleased with Uthman ibn Affan. And Uthman is in Kufa. And it was a time of fitna, by the way, that the Rafid and the Shia were really arguing and going back and forth with the Ahl Sunnah. فَقَالَ سَعِيدٌ, he said, قُلْتُ لَهُ وَأَنْتَ يَرْحَمُكَ اللَّهُ. سَعِيدٌ أَبِي عَرُوبَ said, also may Allah have rahmah on you, Abu Hanifa. فَمَا سَمِيتُ أَحَدًا فِي هَذَا الْبَلَدِ يَتَرَحَمُ عَلَى عُثْمَانِ بْنِ عَفَانَ غَيْرًا. Since I came to Kufa, I haven't heard anyone send rahmah on Uthman ibn Affan other than you. فَعَرَفْتُ فَضْلَهُ, and I realized the virtue of this man. So you can imagine he's in a land where percentage of people are not saying this. And he's saying it. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, who died the year 204 Hijriya, he said, مَنْ أَرَادَ الْفِقْهَ, anyone who wants fiqh, فَهُوَ عِيَالٌ إِلَىٰ أَبِي حَنِيفَ. He is in need of the fiqh of Abu Hanifa. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i said. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, what he was known for, and he became known for, is بِالتَّدْقِيقِ فِي الْفِقْهِ. Abu Hanifa was very detailed, تَدْقِيق, very rooted, detailed, in the way he observed fiqh. It wasn't just a mere look. He was دَقِيق, detailed. He would look at small differences and small changes here and there, he would look at it. And the ulama, as I said to you, by consensus and ijma', they agreed upon that. There's no ikhilaf. No one transmitted any dispute regarding Abu Hanifa's fiqh. Okay? The students of Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he had students, noble students. حَمَلُوا عَنْهُ الْعِلْمَ وَنَشَرُوهُ. They took that knowledge from him and they spread it. And as you all know, and are well aware of, that the fuqaha al-ummah, the jurists of this ummah, they are a lot in number. They're not just four. They're actually large in number. Okay? I'm talking about the jurists, the real ones. They are large in number as well. But many of them, their fiqh, it perished and it went. It actually, indatharat fiqhuhum. Their fiqh went and it died. The reason is because they didn't have students who were carrying on their knowledge and their legacy, who were spreading it. Like for instance, Sufyan al-Thawri, faqih, imam in fiqh. But where's his madhab? Indatharat. From the fuqaha, whose madhab also kind of weirded out, is Al-Layth ibn Sa'd, Al-Uza'i. These are fuqaha, jurists. But their madhabs didn't spread because they didn't have students who took it and they spread it to the world. There wasn't. Okay? The same is with what? Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari had a madhab. Rahimahullah ta'ala. The same thing is with him. His madhab didn't spread. But Abu Hanifa, he had students, very well-known students. From his students were Abu Yusuf, Ya'qub ibn Ibrahim al-Ansari al-Qadhi, rahimahullah, who died the year 182 Hijriya. Al-Imam Abu Yusuf, Ya'qub ibn Ibrahim al-Ansari, the majority of his verdicts and his answers and his response are the statements of Abu Hanifa. Majority of it. The ghalibu aqwalihi wa fatawih. The majority of his verdicts and the majority of his statements, Abu Yusuf is Abu Hanifa. Even that though there are times where he opposed Al-Imam Abu Hanifa in a large amount of masail, but the overwhelming majority of the times he's in line with Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, he was one who used to nurture his students. He used to nurture his students على الأخذ بالدليل, to take the evidences, والعمل بالحديث, and to also what? To implement the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, sorry, Imam Abu Yusuf, who is a student of Abu Hanifa, even that though he was a faqih, a person of fiqh and understanding, he used to take the fiqh of Abu Hanifa. And sometimes he would oppose the fiqh of Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah ta'ala. From the students of Al-Imam Abu Hanifa is who? And so Abu Yusuf, by the way, he became a qadi for two of the Muslim leaders from the Khulafa ibn Abbas. The first one of them is Musa al-Hadi and also Harun al-Rashid. Those two, he was a qadi for them, judge. And qadha is a mas'ala that requires deep fiqh. From the students of Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, is his name is Zufar ibn Hudaylin al-Ambariyu thumma al-Tamimiyu. He died the year 157 or 8, one of the two. Hijriya rahimahullah ta'ala. And he's from the kibar ashabi Abi Hanifa. He is from the noble students of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. And he was very well known for fiqh. And it used to be said, he is from the best students of Abu Hanifa. Especially in the chapters of Al-Qiyas and an analogy. When Al-Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah died, Zufar ibn al-Hudayl al-Ambari rahimahullah, he took the place of Abu Hanifa. So he was the Khalifa of Abu Hanifa. I mean, he sat in the seat of Abu Hanifa once he died. Also from one of the famous students of Abu Hanifa is Muhammad ibn al-Hassan al-Shaybani rahimahullah. Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani died at the year 189 Hijriya. He was from one of the longest students of Abu Hanifa. He was grounded in fiqh of Abu Hanifa, knew it very well. And he is also the narrator of the fiqh of Imam Abu Hanifa. He was also a faqihan, aliman, rahimahullah ta'ala, in other fields. Al-Imam Muhammad ibn al-Hassan al-Shaybani. He narrated from Al-Imam Malik, rahimahullah, Muhammad ibn al-Hassan al-Shaybani. He also narrated from Sufyan al-Thawri and other than them. But he stuck with Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah. And then after that, he stuck with Abu Yusuf. And he took from him as well. And what many people don't know is, Muhammad ibn al-Hassan al-Shaybani, when Imam Abu Hanifa died, he was only 18 years of age. When Imam Abu Hanifa died, Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani was only 18. That's how old he was. So the majority of the fiqh of Abu Hanifa is transmitted through Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani. The reason is because he stuck with him so much, rahimahullah, Imam Abu Hanifa, and he also lived long after that. And Imam Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani, he had mujalasa and sits with Imam al-Shafi'i where they debated. They debated and they had niqashat ulmiya. And Shafi'i, when he saw Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani, he was amazed with him. And he used to really honor him and respect him in his fiqh. Not only that, he used to praise him in his fasaha, his eloquency. ولذلك الإمام الشافعي, he said, ما رأيت قط رجلا سمينا أعقل منه. I never saw a chubby man more smarter than Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. When the people, when they become chubby, all they think about is food and sleep, and they lose value. لكن الإمام الشافعي said, ما رأيت, I never saw قط whatsoever رجلا سمينا, a man who is a chubby man, أعقل منه, more smarter than Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani. وكان أفصح الناس, he was one of the most eloquent of people in speech. Shafi'i is saying this. Shafi'i is he's a proof in the language. He's a proof. He's an evidence in the Arabic language, Imam Shafi'i. He's saying, are you with me? He's saying about who? Muhammad ibn al-Hasan al-Shaybani, that he's a what? أفصح الناس, he's one of the most fasih, his language is clean and correct. كان إذا تكلم خيل إلى سامعه أن القرآن نزل بلغته. That if he spoke, a listener would think that the Quran was sent down in his language, this man's language, the way he spoke, his language. And Imam Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani was very chubby, he was thaqil, jism. And he was very well known for what? Eloquency. But many people, what they don't know is, Imam Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani, his chubbiness was not due to his eating. Rather, it was said that he used to fast the fasting of Dawood. كان يصوم صيام داود. He used to fast the fasting of Dawood. ولذلك, some of the people who traveled with Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani and stayed with him realized that he doesn't eat much. But there's some people, if they eat a lot, they never get chubby. They can eat as much as they want. And another group of people, if they swallow their saliva, they get chubby from it. صح? It's just the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills and does things. And this is something you need to realize, generally speaking, that as Imam al-Qahtani says in his Nuniya, وَجُسُومُ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ غَيْرَ السِّمَانِ. The flesh and the bodies of the scholars is generally not chubby. You never used to see that in the time of the Salaf. Scholars who were fat and chubby. Scholars were known for قِلَّةُ الدُّنْيَا. Their dunya was little, very small. They were known for that. Anyone who looks at Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen, Sheikh ibn Baz, Albani was a bit compared to the two I mentioned. But even him wasn't, you wouldn't say chubby, he was normal. Are you with me? Qillatul dunya you would see from them. Their worldly life was very simple. Khasan Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen was very, very small. Very skinny, Sheikh ibn Uthaymeen, extremely skinny. The ulama were always like that. Dunya, they ate little, they drank little. You know why? Anyone who fills his stomach to the fullest is bound to go to sleep and not wake up and not produce anything. The mind, the person's mind, it shuts if the person fills himself with food. If a person eats little, they can produce a lot. لذلك fasting Mondays and Thursdays, or even eating once or twice a day, is something that increases your energy, and not eating much. And especially if the person is eating what is very healthy. If you're eating healthy food, is even better. Now that we've mentioned about Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, who is the Imam of the Madhab al-Hanafiyya, and we gave an understanding and a very summarized, very short biography of his. And we also spoke about his students and who they were. We're now going to mention, inshallah ta'ala, the ulama, the scholars, what they mentioned that the Hanafi madhab had gone through. The Hanafi madhab, it went through bithalathati atwar, three levels. So the Hanafi madhab, we can summarize it into three stages, in three levels, and three periods. The first طور الأول, the first period, is called طور النشوء والتكوين. And this is the time in which, or this stage is placing the bricks, the foundations. It's basically the building of the Hanafi madhab. And as we all know, this starts from the time of the Imam himself, and Imam Abu Hanifa, and the time of his students, until the death of Al-Hassan ibn Ziyad al-Lu'lu'i, who died the year 204. This period, so from the time of Abu Hanifa rahimahullah until the time of Al-Hassan ibn Ziyad al-Lu'lu'i, who died the year 204, this is called the stage of Tawr al-Nushu'i wa-Takween. And it's basically the stage of placing the foundations and the building of the Madhab al-Hanafiyyah. The second stage that the Hanafi Madhab can be categorized into is طور التوسع والنمو. And this is the period in which the Hanafi Madhab spread and it grew. And this starts from the period after the death of Al-Hassan ibn Ziyad al-Lu'lu'i, which is 204 onwards, until the death of Al-Imam Abil Barakat Abdullah ibn Ahmad al-Nasafi. And his death was 710 Hijriah. That period of time is the period where you call it Tawr al-Tawassu' wal-Numu. And many of the ulama, they refer to that period of time as the death of the khatima, the ending of the death of the final and last mujtahid of the madhab. That period of time, they say that the mujtahidi al-madhab, the scholars who could do ijtihad within the Hanafi madhab, this is when they all went. Anything after, anyone who came after that, were not referred to as the mujtahidi al-madhab. And this is the ending of who? Al-Imam Abi al-Barakat Abdullah ibn Ahmad al-Nasafi, who died the year 710 Hijriah. Then you have the last and final stage, which is known as Tawr al-Istiqrar, the period in which the madhab grounded itself, it polished its fiqh. And this is basically from the time of Of course, Al-Imam Abu al-Barakat Abdullah ibn Ahmad al-Nasafi's time until our day today. This is basically called the Tawr al-Istiqrar, when the madhab is grounded and it's rooted. Because each of these stages are very long, and a lot of discussion is going to be regarding it, I think it's a wise decision not to start it and not to touch on any of the three, and to pause here for today and to carry on next week by talking about all three of them, inshallah ta'ala. Because the first one itself is going to take all next week, and then the second one is going to take all next week, the week after, and then the third will take itself the week after. So if we do start the first stage right now and we talk about it, we won't even reach halfway. And what's going to happen is that we're going to come next week and then have to recap what we mentioned last week again. And it's better that it's connected together. So I'm going to conclude there, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and Shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.